Warning, the following video contains explicit language which may be offensive to some viewers or inappropriate for children. The content within this video is intended for mature audiences only.
Are you ready?
Welcome to the show. So I have some really fun news to share with you today. Right-wingers, right-wing insiders more specifically, have finally turned on failed Republican candidate Carrie Lake. It's pretty delicious. So here's why. Here's what they're saying, and just a little juicy nugget for you. So Lake, as you guys all know, she lost her race for Arizona governor in 2022. And she has been fighting for 2 years to overturn that loss. She has managed to get herself sued for defamation because of her election fraud lies. But she was pretty much still is, I would say, a MAGA favorite because of her blind loyalty to Donald Trump and her refusal to tell the truth about Republicans losing elections. So Lake decided she's going to run for the Senate this year, and she easily became the Republican nominee. But her poll numbers, as I've shared with you guys, they have just worsened as the year has gone on. So she has consistently been losing in the polls, trailing behind her Democratic challenger, Ruben Gallego. And we're not talking about a few points and within the margin of error. Most of the recent polling shows Lake losing to Gallego by double digits. And this is really telling. So journalist Yasher Ali posted on X, quote, or Twitter, I will call it, updated Fox News poll of Arizona's Senate race shows that Ruben Gallego up 13% over Carrie Lake. When it comes to women voters, Gallego has a 23-point advantage over Lake. And while most of MAGA may only care about making libs cry, the more serious MAGA members are starting to see Lake as a liability. They see her as a, you know, dead weight around the ankle of the Republican Party. So last week, the dam started to break and right-wingers started issuing her political eulogy. What kicked it off was a Marist poll that showed a significant share of Trump voters are not going to be voting for Lake in November. So they're going to split the ticket. The Marist poll shows Trump winning Arizona by 1 point, but it shows Lake down by 10 to Gallego. So in response to this abysmal polling, an Arizona Central journalist named Lori Roberts wrote an opinion piece that likened Lake's campaign to that of North Carolina candidate Mark Robinson. Not good. I mean, this is the guy you might know from what I've shared with you guys. He has had too many scandals to count. He was recently outed for allegedly calling himself a black Nazi and saying that he has been having sex, or years ago was having sex with his quote unquote hot ass sister-in-law. This is who this guy is, saying that he loves, you know, Mein Kampf, you know, he's pro Hitler. I mean, just a freak. So Roberts detailed the groups that favor Gallego, and most importantly, she wrote, quote, independents, the ones who decide Arizona races, are breaking 2-1 for Gallego, 64% to 32%. It's almost as if insulting John McCain voters was a bad thing in Arizona, where they loved him. Imagine that. And it seems that the more people get to know Lake, the less they like her. Not really what you want to hear as a candidate, right? We liked you till we met you. We liked you until you opened your mouth. So Roberts pointed out that Lake's been campaigning consistently for 2 years, and her unfavorable rating went from 42% in 2022. So 2 years ago, she had 42%. She was still underwater, but 42%. Now her unfavorable is 51%. I mean, I shouldn't say she was underwater. She, was still in negative territory under the 50% mark. So now a majority of people, a slight majority of people in Arizona hate Carrie Lake. Only 39% of Arizona residents now have a favorable opinion of her. Not good. Roberts also said, quote, "Another day, another heaping helping of disaster for Arizona's reigning queen of the Make America Great Again movement. When this election is over, Republicans should really begin asking themselves when and if they ever want to win again. Because if it wasn't clear after already losing two Senate seats and every key statewide office, it's about to become undeniably clear to all but the fiercest MAGA diehards. Moderates aren't going to support a far-right firebrand." Roberts went on to say that every Republican operative that she's spoken to is saying that this race is over. So she quoted a few of them. There was a Republican consultant named Chuck Coughlin. He told her, quote, "You can put that one in the deep freeze." Another GOP strategist named Barrett Marson told Roberts, quote, "She is probably beyond help by now." And Republican consultant Tyler Montag, he jumped on the dog pile and he said, quote, "I don't think there's enough money and time for Lake to rehabilitate her image." And then Roberts ended her article with, quote, "I picture the late Senator John McCain somewhere in the hereafter laughing his head off." And we're all laughing with him, really. I know I am. And I have to share this with you guys. It is hysterical on so many levels. So the Arizona Republican Party put up this billboard that you see here on your screen. For people listening on the podcast, it's a photo of Tulsi Gabbard, JD Vance, Donald Trump, Robert F. Kennedy Jr., Elon Musk, and Vivek Ramaswamy. This is the Arizona Republican Party that put this up. And it says unity. It's like the unity ticket, right? So, where to start? The party is so done with Lake that they didn't even include her on this Arizona billboard. She is the state candidate for the U.S. Senate, and they see her as such a liability that they didn't put her on the billboard that says unity. They have people on this billboard who aren't even running for office, but not Carrie Lake. They have former Democrats on here. Tulsi Gabbard is a former Democrat. Kennedy was a Democrat up until like 2 seconds ago. And he was calling Donald Trump a piece of crap up until about 2 seconds ago, but not Carrie Lake. She's nowhere to be found. They even have Musk, Elon Musk, who isn't even a politician. And none, not a single one of these people has anything to do with Arizona. This is so sad. This is like if they were throwing a party at Carrie Lake's house and they told her, "You're not invited." Hey, we're going to use your house for the night. We're throwing a rager over here. Sorry, you're not welcome. This is too good. It is so good. Oh my God. Anyway, I enjoyed this immensely, as you can tell. Because she's such a... Here's the thing. Mike Lindell, he's just brain dead. I mean, honestly, I mean, the guy did so many drugs. He admits that, right? He's just not all there. I don't think he's that bright to begin with. Drugs didn't help. So I don't think he knows that Donald Trump didn't win. But Carrie Lake, regardless of what else you have to say about her, and I got a lot to say about her, you may have a lot of thoughts on her, but she is smart. The woman is smart. Okay, you cannot take that away from her. She knows Donald Trump didn't win. She knows the election fraud lie is a lie. She knows it's bullshit. She knows that she didn't win her election. She knows she has no evidence. That's why she gave up in the defamation lawsuit and said, okay, yeah, I'll just take my lumps, figure out what I owe you, and, you know, we'll be done with this. Because she knows she has no evidence. She knows it's not true, that she used it just to become a MAGA favorite. So that is what pisses me off the most about her over people like Lindell, because she is smart enough to know better. And she was also a Democrat until, like, you know, 3 seconds ago, who voted for Obama. But she saw, you know, where the mood of the country was, and she's an attention whore. And so she's like, oh, I'm just going to throw my hat in the ring on the Republican side, suck up to Donald Trump, you know, pretend that I'm all on board with the Stop the Steal BS, and I'll stay relevant, and I'll, you know, get out there. I'll be invited to speak at all these events. So it's such a cynical play. It's just gross. So that's what pisses me off about her over other people who are just too stupid to know any better or too naive. So anyway, that's what makes this just so much fun. So I will let you know when I hear more. But yeah, I think it's safe to say her political career is done. She is done. You know, once, twice, they're not even going to wait for three times a loser. So, all right. Thank you all so much for watching and listening. Please like, please share, and subscribe. Please donate if you can. Love you all. Take care.
Talk with you. Hey, everybody, it's Jeff. Nice day here in Maine today, as it was yesterday, and breezy. You saw the Carrie Lake video there, I guess. yeah, that was recorded like a day ago, okay, by what's her name, the other one that did the video. But just about an hour or two ago, this story come out from the Daily Beast, okay, written by Lily Mae Lazarus, and it's entitled Carrie Lake's Rival Reveals His Dad is a Convicted Drug Dealer. Democrat Senate candidate Ruben Gallego responded to shock accusations tying him to drug cartels lodged by rival political Carrie Lake. The failed Arizona gubernatorial candidate and MAGA ally claimed Gallego was, quote, controlled by the cartels, unquote, and that, quote, his own father was a Colombian drug trafficker, unquote, during a September 30 appearance on Newsmax. Gallego, who currently represents Arizona's 3rd congressional district, addressed Lake's claims on Thursday, revealing that his father, with whom he has no relationship, is a, quote, convicted drug dealer, unquote, and that, quote, it's a stain on that our family has to carry, unquote. Quote, this is why my mom, my sisters, and myself have worked our entire lives to really live the American dream and to serve and honor this country despite what he has done, unquote, he said, becoming emotional as he spoke. A congressman who leads heavily in the polls with margins ranging from 4 to 14 percentage points called Lake a, quote, pathetic loser. Quote, this is who Carrie Lake is, unquote, Gallego continued. quote, she attacks families when she is losing, unquote. The right-wing firebrand has a track record of being a sore loser. Lake ascended to prominence in the Republican Party, began while backing false claims that Donald Trump was robbed of Arizona's electoral votes after widespread voter fraud in 2020. 2 years later, she ran for governor of the Grand Canyon State, an election she lost and similarly challenged using baseless accusations of Democrat-led mass voter fraud. Lake and Gallego first butted heads in 23 when the pair were on the same flight from Washington to Phoenix. Gallego, who instigated, took to X, writing, quote, hey, Carrie Lake, we're on the same plane. Just come back from first class to coach and we can chat. Happy to walk you through all my legislative work to deliver key resources to Arizona's border communities, unquote. Lake shot back with a link to a news story about Gallego owning a house near Capitol Hill and wrote, quote, I feel free to say hi, Ruben. I can help with your homesickness. I know it's got to be difficult for you to leave your full-time residence in D.C. and visit the people you pretend to represent, unquote. Sources told the New York Times that upon landing, Lake, quote, ambushed, unquote, Gallego, recording and berating him with questions. Well, that shouldn't be of any surprise that she would do something like that, okay? She's a dirty, dirty campaigner. And Gallego, who's, out ahead of her, she's going to find any damn thing she can find, okay? And Gallego is right to, get out in front of it. Don't hide from it. Don't hide from it. Just let people know. That was my father. That's not me. Okay? Because he did all these wrong things doesn't mean I'm going to do these wrong things. Okay? She couldn't find any dirt on him. Okay? So she had to go after the family. Right? So what does that tell you? Gallego, he's fine. There's nothing wrong with him. Okay? Everybody's family has somebody in it that's done something stupid, okay? I don't know any family that hasn't got their hands in some kind of problem or other, okay? Imagine if you dug into Carrie Lake's family history, you're going to find shit there that she doesn't want people to know about, okay? But I don't think Gallego is going to stoop to that level. He's running against her, not her family, just her, okay? But with Carrie Lake, she's not enough for herself. She can't seem to win, and she's getting pissed off at losing. So, for people to say that her political career is sinking, yeah, it is, but this is the kind of woman that's not going to go down quietly, okay? Remember that. She's a stubborn bitch, okay? And she was the perfect... I don't know why Trump didn't pick her to run as his VP, to be honest, because she would seem more likely to be by his side. But because he's so misogynistic, I guess he wouldn't do it anyway, right? But it's just the idea that, she's so mean-spirited, and the fact that MAGA is running out of steam with her. And MAGA as a whole, the popularity of MAGA is even running out of steam, all right? Because a lot of Republicans have thrown up the white flag and said, fuck it, we just can't go any further with MAGA anymore. They've ruined us. We probably will never win elections again. And, it's just, Carrie Lake just doesn't do it for them anymore. I haven't seen her face on the news for quite a while, in fact. So I can tell you the media is not interested in her anymore. MAGA's not bringing her name up anymore. Christ, they won't even talk about her much anymore. And... what can I say? The only place that would talk to her is Newsmax, and that's as far right as you can get. But, who watches that? there's more people that watch Fox News than they do Newsmax. But the thing is that it's just a sign of MAGA, at the twilight of its existence, okay? When Donald Trump loses again, okay, for the White House, that's going to be another death nail in their coffin, okay? But they're not going to go away. Like I said before, they started off as being the teabagger movement. Then they morphed into this. They'll morph into something else. Okay? That's what they do. These are changelings, these fucking people here. That's what they are. Okay? they change to, you know, to adapt to what made them fail the last time. They'll try and do better the next time, you know, maybe three times a charm, who fucking knows, okay? But you know, Trump won't be the guy, it'll be somebody else, and Carrie Lake won't be part of that movement either. She'll just either disappear, or she'll just, you know, move closer to the center, you know, hoping that maybe moderate Republicans will take her, which I doubt. She doesn't seem like a person that many people like. I certainly don't like her. The things that she said were pretty hateful, you know, and I think she did it because she was trying to draw Trump's attention. And I just think that, you know, she's really not what you'd call, you know, prime candidate anymore for anything. So who knows? I mean, but with this story here, you know, yeah, it probably will hit Gallego a little bit. People hear about that. But that's only because people can't think the way I'm thinking about it. It's not him. It's his family. Okay? It's his father. You know, you can't say, you know, you can't make everybody say you're the same as your criminal dad. I mean, there's like a whole bunch of shows on TV about people who are sons and daughters and, you know what I'm saying, of family members who are in the mob. Okay? And these people live normal, healthy American lives, but their fathers are sitting in prison or they're on death row, okay? So what are you going to do? You're actually going to say that they're the same as that person? It doesn't work that way, okay? It's not in your DNA. DNA doesn't make you a criminal, okay? I'm sorry. It's how you, it's the facts of life that you learned, okay? The things you were exposed to. And I would imagine that Gallego's father probably tried not to expose his son to much of what he was doing because he didn't want his son to be like that. That's a lot of criminals are that way. They want their kids to be better than they are, all right? I mean, why do you think BTK tried to hide the shit he was doing from his family, his own family? Because he didn't want them to think that he was a bad person, and he was trying to, you know, he's being religious with his kids and stuff, trying to impress on them some values. But are any of those people out there doing BTK's work? No, they're all living regular lives. You see what I'm saying? It doesn't work that way, okay? And then sometimes it could be the opposite. A father and mother, they might be completely sane and healthy and do and treat their kids good, but the kid will grow up and you'll be a fucking Ted Bundy. You know what I'm saying? Okay, so you cannot say that DNA decides what you're going to be. Okay, it doesn't work that way. I'm sorry. But this argument here with Carrie Lake trying to, you know, spin some yarn here to make it look like that Gallego, you know, is a criminal just like his dad, it doesn't work. That's as thin a fucking argument as a sheet of paper. Okay, and you can poke holes in there to drive a truck through. So I'm hoping that people down there more or less will understand that and say, okay, that was his fucking dad. Okay, so anyway, let's go to commercial break. We'll be here.
This is me.
This is me.
This is me.
This is me. I'm Alex Curtis. I'm a lobsterman in Maine, and this is me.
I'm Ruth McLaughlin, and this is me.
I'm Eric Hopkins. I'm an artist, and this is me.
This is me.
Me. Me.
This is me.
This is me.
This is me.
At the end of the journey, the main thing is you, original.
Can't you see me? I am burning, burning. My whole body's burning, burning. I am burning. Body's burning, burning. Blue ocean is falling, falling.
Against you.
You might have seen a couple of days ago Donald Trump's already dwindling crowd get even smaller.
Even the spy Mitch McConnell and Karl Rove sent to keep an eye on you. Chris LaCivita likes them, knows them, worked for people like Mitch McConnell and Bush for decades.
And a new poll indicates Harris is surging in the Sunbelt states.
He didn't want to work for you, but it seems like he's still working for them, giving you bad advice, steering you wrong.
Donald Trump supporters now either are dressing up his empty seats at his rallies, or the guy has a serious problem getting people to show up for him.
Embarrassing you. J.D. Vance, he let you choose that embarrassment, costing you money. And if you didn't win, he's just fine. He goes back to working for Karl Rove or Mitch McConnell or the rest of the establishment GOP who hate you. Because you're paying Rove's guy, McConnell's guy, and he doesn't believe in you at all.
Driver's license, registration.
Here you go, sir. How's your day going?
That's your daughter?
Sure is.
Abigail, right?
How do you know her?
Were you about 8 weeks pregnant? See, you've been spotting recently. You've had any cramps or nausea?
That's personal.
You been taking your prenatal vitamins?
Excuse me?
Are you ticketing me for something?
Where are you heading, Abigail?
To go see my older sister, Natalie.
Well, that's strange. This says here that Natalie's at a concert in Dallas. And your navigation is set to a women's health clinic in one of those abortion states.
We have the right to travel.
Not anymore. Step out of the car.
Please, officer.
Both of you out now. You, sir, are under arrest for crossing state lines to obtain an abortion for a minor under your care. And you, young lady, well, you're under arrest for evading motherhood.
Be a part of the entertainment value of a lifetime.
I loved it.
It was the best performance I've seen in a lifetime.
I loved the show. I liked it very much. He's a very entertaining man. It's well worth the money.
Now appearing in Charlottetown, coming to Halifax November 6th to the 18th, and St. John November 20th through the 26th.
All right, so that's a ridiculous and silly question. I want to commend you for being the media and telling it Democrat policy. So let me ask you something.
Come on, man. That's been going on for 20 years.
Yeah, Let me ask you something. Let me ask you something. What rate of illegal immigration did we have in 2020? Do you know anything? I asked you a question.
How long have you been in office?
Do you know anything?
How long have you been in office?
I've been in office 11 years now.
And this has been kicked the can down in multiple administrations.
Except you're wrong. Okay, you don't get to argue with me. You asked your question. You asked your question. You don't get. You want to hold a press conference? You can do it over there.
How are you?
You want to hold a press conference? You can do it over there.
How are
So hold on. I'm going to answer his question.
Things are heating up here in Texas. And no, I'm not just talking about the fact that it's still 90 degrees outside in October. No, I'm talking about the Senate race between Ted Cruz and his Democratic challenger, Colin Allred.
Folks are saying around the country what we know to be true here in Texas, which is that I'm going to beat Ted Cruz.
The latest polls are promising. Allred has broken the tie and is finally up by 1 point. Ted, I love to remind people, came dangerously close to losing his seat to the frightfully progressive for Texas, Beto O'Rourke, in 2018. So while a 1 point lead is hardly anything to get excited over usually, it is somewhat significant here in Texas. Of course, it's still within the margin of error, and these polls are less than reliable on the best days. On top of that, Texans are reluctant to hope because our hopes have been dashed so many times before. But why was Ted Cruz so antagonistic toward the guy in the clip we watched?
Except you're wrong. Okay, you don't get to argue with me. You asked your question.
Ted was asked what he's done to work with the Biden administration, and it was a reasonable question because after serving as the senator from Texas for 11 years now, Ted Cruz is trying to rebrand his image going into November's election. He's trying to tell people who he is now, which is apparently different from who he has been for the last 11 years. And who he is now is bipartisan. And according to Cruz, he's really always been bipartisan.
This border deal was misguided from the beginning. Why is that? Because this deal was drafted by the Democrats. It was negotiated with the Democrats.
In an interview with Politico, Cruz, who's known for being super partisan actually, said that his reputation for being one of the most hardline members of the Senate just isn't right. He said, "What is new is not that I'm passing bipartisan legislation that helps produce jobs in Texas. I've been doing that since the day I arrived in the Senate. What is new is we're finally getting the press to report on it." The man has a right-wing podcast that he spends more time hosting than he does governing, not to mention the fact that he was a key part of the January 6th attempt to overturn the 2020 election results. And speaking of which, when he was asked by Caitlin Collins on CNN if he would accept the 2024 election results, he called the question ridiculous, which seems to be his go-to when he gets asked questions he doesn't like, and then he proceeded to not really answer the so-called ridiculous question.
You were the first senator to object to the votes. Mm-hmm. In 2024, will you certify the election results? Do you plan to object, or will you accept the results regardless of who wins the election?
So, Caitlin, I got to say, I think that's actually a ridiculous question.
It's a yes or no question, though.
No, it's not. Let me explain why it's a ridiculous question. It's not a question. You've ever asked a Democrat that?
Of course.
What Democrat?
But hold
on a second. What Democrats challenge it?
What Democrats? I know. I've been down this road many times.
But
no Democrat. You cannot compare the two situations. We have talked about that. We've seen the audio of that when they protested on the Senate floor.
But hold on a second.
Has you ever had a sitting president who refused to facilitate the peaceful transition of power, refused to acknowledge that his successor won the presidency?
We did have a peaceful transfer of power. I was there on January 20th. I was there on the swearing-in.
Barely.
Following the January 6th insurrection, Cruz called the riot a terrorist attack, only to later recant after Tucker Carlson pressed him on it. He said that it would be ridiculous for him to call people protesting a terrorist attack. He was talking specifically about the really dangerous people who committed violence against cops. Those were the terrorists. Suddenly, it's not so cool to be a far-right sucking-up-to-Trump who called your wife ugly MAGA Republican podcaster. Not only that, but it's not cool to be a Republican in a state where the maternal death rate has increased by 56% after a Republican-led abortion ban went into effect in 2019. And the people of Texas know who to blame for this. While the Republicans call us childless cat ladies with no stake in our futures, women in Texas and other similar states across the country are afraid to get pregnant because of Republican policies. Check out this ad that's currently running here in Texas.
It's gotten more dangerous to be a woman in Texas.
And it's Ted Cruz's fault. He fought for an abortion ban that goes too far.
They didn't just make it illegal to have an abortion, they made it illegal for me to do my job.
So whether you were raped or something went tragically wrong and your life is at risk,
women are now forced to flee Texas for care. I'm not a political person.
But seeing what I've seen,
I can never vote for Ted Cruz.
I can never vote for Ted Cruz.
I was watching Bob's Burgers the other night, which is like my feel-good show when I don't want to think about the world or anyone in it. And it was interrupted with Ted Cruz, of all people. Gotta love election season. Also, did Hulu change something? Like, why am I getting ads there now? Anyway, Ted is now trying to toe the line that he has so often scorned. He's voted to not shut down the government, which is nice of him. He insists that his vote against IVF and birth control access wasn't because he doesn't actually support those things. It was because it was a backdoor Democrat-led effort to skirt abortion laws in red states, so he says. Also, he's voted for tax relief for hurricane victims. How interesting. As we get closer to November, the moniker of Cancun Cruz is lurking behind Ted as he campaigns across Texas. Texans have not forgotten, nor have they forgiven, the way that when faced with our own natural disaster, a disaster, by the way, that was largely manufactured by incompetent Republican leadership, fled the state for Cancun rather than stay and do his job. And the people who supported Ted Cruz through him leaving the state love to ask, well, what could he have done anyway? Well, solidarity with the people that you campaigned to serve would have been literally the least you could have done. But Beto O'Rourke, who lost the Senate race to Ted Cruz, and Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, who doesn't even live in Texas, certainly found a way to help. AOC aided with food drives and distribution, and Beto organized heating zones and arranged for safe transportation for the elderly to get them to those heating zones. Ted did nothing and then lied about it once he was caught. Then he went to Florida to make fun of the Texans who were mad at him for leaving and then lying. And that incident will hopefully haunt Ted Cruz right out of office in November. Never forget. All right, that's it for me. If you got anything out of this, please like the video and subscribe to the channel for more. Thanks.
Okay, welcome back. So, Ted Cruz, another one that's suffering there, another MAGA nut. He's struggling in Texas right now. People down there have a really good memory of him and how and kind of what he's done. I mean, he's been politician for 11 years, I guess. But he hasn't always been the best for them in that state, okay? And he said some pretty wild shit, okay? I think probably in an attempt to get Trump's attention. I don't know, but he's certainly not a guy that you would want in any position representing your state or, you know, people or even a fucking town, okay? And here's a story anyway that's come out from Mediaite, written by Alex Griffin. This is today. Entitled, Pollster Breaks Down Ted Cruz's Cancun Problem in Re-Election Bid. Abandon us when we needed him. Cook, Political Report senior editor Jessica Taylor spoke to C-SPAN's John McArdle on Washington Journal on Thursday and explained why Senator Cruz is facing a serious re-election challenge this year, his Cancun problem. Quote, every race is a potential majority maker in the Senate this year. This week, you wrote about Senator Cruz's race against Democratic Congressman Colin Allred, a race that's becoming more competitive with less than 5 weeks to go until Election Day, McCarles began. Quote, yeah, I mean, and this is good news for Democrats because they haven't. The overall map is very hard for Democrats. They have a 51-49 majority, but it functionally starts at 50-50 because they're going to lose that West Virginia seat with Joe Manchin retiring, Taylor replied, adding, so that means they cannot afford to lose any incumbent, and they have to win, and they have to have Vice President Kamala Harris win the presidency. Now Montana is one that we moved a couple weeks ago. John Tester is by far the most vulnerable incumbent, and we see him as the underdog. So we shifted that race to lean Republican. So that means that if Democrats still want a viable path to the majority, they have to find another offensive target. And increasingly, Texas is becoming that target. You have Ted Cruz, of course. He won by less than 3 points in 2018 against Beto O'Rourke. That was in a midterm election. though in presidential elections should be harder in Texas. But there's a couple of unique things happening. Ted Cruz is polarizing, and you know, he's tried to, you know, he's emphasized his work as a legislator. He's sort of toned down the bombastic personality that we know, but he's running against Colin Allred, who is a more centrist congressman. Flipped his seat in 2018 from red to blue in the midterm election, then he was drawn into a safe seat. So we really could have stayed in this suburban Dallas set for as long as he wanted, but Democrats convincing him to run for Senate was really quite the coup. And so he's been able to fundraise. In fact, the latest numbers here in Texas, he's already spent almost $50 million, and between Allred's campaign versus Cruz and his allies, have only spent about $22.3 million. So that heavy advantage on air has enabled, I think, Allred to raise his name ID to get his message out there. And there are two things that I think Cruz is uniquely vulnerable on. Abortion is now, of course, a bigger issue than it was in 2018 after the Dobbs decision. Texas is one of the most restrictive laws in the country. And then Cancun. I was watching a focus group a couple weeks ago of undecided Trump voters in the Senate race, and they immediately brought up Cancun, which in 2021, after the state was hit hard with a winter storm, power outages, the power grid failed, Cruz went with his family on a vacation to Mexico. He was very much assailed for this. There was sort of this iconic image of him coming back rolling a suitcase with a Texas mask. Allred features that in a lot of his ads, talks about Ted Cruz abandoning us when we needed him, and so I think it sort of further inflames why people have very strong feelings about Ted Cruz. But you see Republicans now putting more money in the race, painting Allred, as you know, tied to Harris and Biden, particularly on immigration. But we're seeing tightening poll numbers here and increased spending. McCarl followed up, quote, "That's why I want to focus on the poll numbers. It is because Texas is the best bad option for Democrats with not a lot of targets. Or is there actually polling here showing that Allred has a path?" Unquote. Quote, "We've seen it between, I've seen polling between 2 and 3 points, I think probably with Cruz ahead. Yes, Cruz is still leading, and you know, I think Republicans have it slightly larger. But in public polling, we have seen it in that. But I think also those last 2 to 3 points in Texas are just Herculean," unquote. Taylor replied, concluding, "But I think it's your right. It is sort of the best bad option. It's still very difficult, but the fact that Allred is raising his own money and can get those lower candidate races. And when it comes to advertising, you know, I think in order, the other bucket is Florida, of course. Senator Rick Scott also up for re-election there. Also, you know, has had issues with his approval ratings and favorability. But Debbie Mircarskill Powell, his Democratic opponent, has just not been able to fundraise at the level that already has. Now we have National Democrats, the Democratic Senatorial Campaign Committee, said this week or said last week, they're putting money in both races. So far we've seen that show. We've seen that show up in hybrid ads and things, but I think that when you look at sort of where the money is and the fact that Ted Cruz can't write himself a check versus Rick Scott in Florida, who is a multimillionaire, can. So people, you know, Cruz, his popularity there in Texas is hurting too, just like Kerry Lake. Maybe not as bad as Kerry Lake, but it is hurting because people do remember what he did. You know, you don't abandon your fucking state or the people you represent at a time of crisis. Okay, that's going to hurt you politically. Talk to Donald Trump. He'll tell you that because that's what he did, when he was president. He abandoned this country when it was fighting with COVID-19. He wasn't there for us. And that's how he lost his election. It wasn't anything else he did. But that was the one fucking reason why he lost. Okay, I don't care all the other shit that he did while he was president that everybody thought was wrong. It was how he handled COVID is what killed him in the end. Okay. And that's what people need to remember about Trump and about Ted Cruz, is that when the time came for them to step up to show just how much of a leader they are, they failed. They failed, you know? And so why would anybody even think, you know, you know, they're only going to vote for him because they want an R in that fucking seat. That's the only reason why they stay loyal to these fucks, is because they are Republican, you know, and they want to keep them in there. It has nothing to do about what ideas they have, what policies they want to implement, what corrective measures they want to make or take this country into to improve the economy. It has nothing to do with that. It's like a football game. All they care about is the fucking win. That's it. And once they get in there, anything that they told you they promised they were going to do, just like those three people that went to be in the Supreme Court, they'll tell you anything. But once they got in there, into those seats, right out the window, all that shit said. Okay? That's all they do. And so Ted Cruz can promise them, you know, a golden brick road all the way to the Emerald City, but that's not going to happen. That's not going to happen. Okay? It's just not going to happen. Same thing with Trump. All these things he says he's going to do, oh, it's secure the border and all this other crap that he's promised before and never delivered on. Same old, okay? These people lie for a living. That's what they do. These people lie for a living. And I can't understand why voters always fall for the worst liars out there. Jesus. You know? It really pisses me off. It really does. Because, you know, most people with half a brain can tell when they're being spun a web of lies, okay? Most people can. You know, it's like, you ever watch these crime shows on TV where they're interrogating somebody, right? Okay, and the person is on the hot seat and he's trying to lie his way out of it to save his own ass, okay? You know he's lying, she's lying, okay? You know just by the stupid stories they spin that they're lying. If we can do that by watching a fucking TV show like that and seeing an interrogation and being able to understand or read the body language, why the fuck can't we do that with these politicians? Why the fuck is MAGA out there behind the worst fucking guy in the history of this country running for president? Why can't they see that? That's the big fucking, you know, $100,000 question, isn't it? What the hell do they see in this guy that makes them think that he's anything better than the one he is, okay? What the hell makes them think that? You know, he's proved nothing. He's proved nothing that he's trustworthy. He's proved nothing he has the character or the fortitude to be president. He got his chance to show us that he could, and he failed. He fucking failed. And they're still picking up the pieces of his mess, you know? You know, I have to say that as a cult mentality, there hasn't been one single cult on this earth that has ever survived itself. Okay? Not one. I'm serious. Not a single cult on earth has ever survived itself. It's always ended in disaster. Every single time. Every single time. And MAGA, ladies and gentlemen, is a fucking cult. Because when people are so blind and believe so willingly the shit that they're fed, okay, and they can't, for the life of them, be able to explain to you why they like said person, okay, then you know it's just blind loyalty. That's all it is. And they're in it for something else. It has nothing to do with the person that they're behind. It's in it for, there's a selfish motive behind it. The reason they support Trump. It's selfish. Okay? They think they're getting something out of it. They really do. When you listen to these people and they're certain of it, that, you know, if he wins, they're going to get what they want. And it never works that way. Ever. You know? I can't understand how they don't learn from history. A lot of these people today that are members of MAGA remember the cults in the past. You know, the Jim Jones, the David Koresh's. They remember these fucking cults. They know how they end up. And what are they doing? They're following that same path of logic with this crazy fucker and others like him, like Carrie Lake and Ted Cruz. These are all the same cultish mentalities out there that they're asking you for their loyalty for no cost at all. Okay, trust me and you'll get everything you want. Won't cost you a cent. You know, used car salesman. And I feel like, you know, For those of us out there who are my age or older, we ought to know better. Okay? We really should. We got enough history in our in our pocket here to understand bullshit when we hear it. There's no excuse for, you know, for us older people. Okay, the younger people, yeah, I mean, I could see them falling for it, but, you know, us? Come on. Show some fucking dignity and some brains here. Jesus Christ, use your common sense. Look, read between the lines. Look at that fucking Project 2025, for the love of Christ. Of all things, look at that. That tells you right there there's a fucking momentum, a secret cabal in the workings right there trying to overthrow this country. And you wonder why we're all against Trump. Jesus. What do you think this is anyway? You know, a fucking game? It's not. Not especially when you got real lives on the line here. People's lives can go from good to bad practically overnight, depending on who's running the country. And do you ever hear Trump ever talk anything good about Americans? I don't. I can't think of anything good he's ever said about Americans. He hates everybody, it seems to me. You know, who the hell wants somebody leading them that hates you? You know, I feel like there's really no logic behind this campaign at all. Trump shouldn't even be running. He does not qualify to be president for a lot of reasons, legally and ethically. Okay, there's a lot of reasons here he shouldn't even be running. Okay, in a better United States that still followed its principles, he wouldn't be running. They'd have laughed him out of the race and Republicans would have had to pick somebody else. But because he's a criminal and he's a rapist and he's, you know, a convict, hey, he shouldn't even be in the race. By all rights, he should not be. Okay, and it's only because we have a corrupted Supreme Court that allows it to go on. Otherwise, we could have gone to them and they would have said, you can't run, you know. But because it's Donald Trump and he's got money and he can buy lawyers and he can buy politicians and he can buy judges, you see how easily that, you know, that gets usurped. And if we honored our country's values, that none of that money would have meant anything because nobody would have taken it. All these people would have said no to him. In fact, they'd have arrested him for bribing political leaders and stuff, okay? That's how that would have shook down right there. If this was a government that was honoring its tradition and its values, okay, Trump would already be in prison for trying to meddle in this country's government in the way he's been doing it, and not to mention getting money from another country, which in itself is a crime, okay. He's done that, and so, like I said, there's no sanity at all in putting this guy in the White House. No sanity in that at all. Okay, that's just a nightmare, a Stephen King nightmare, okay, that we don't want to go down that road. Okay, we don't want to go. It's one thing to fantasize about that and write a story or a book, you know, and to make it into a movie. But when it comes to reality, because you cannot end this story and have the credits roll at the end, okay? This is a story of reality, and you cannot turn reality into a fantasy. And that's what MAGA's been doing here, okay? Trump is their fantasy. He's their goddamn fantasy, and they want to see him into the White House. And if he does what I know he's going to do, okay, it's going to be too late. It's going to be too fucking late then, and MAGA's is going to be to blame for it. And I'll tell you, they better hide their faces. They better hide their faces, because there's going to be a lot of people out to hang him, you know, for having pushed him into the White House. So if they were predicting, oh, one day we're going to need our guns to defend the gun, that may be the reason why you want your guns, is because you know you're up to something and you're trying to wreck the country, and they're going to come after you when you do it. That's why, okay? So, yeah. That's how you're going to get the government to come after you, is because they're going to come after anyone who's trying to destroy it from the inside, and that's what you've been doing. Jesus Christ! I mean, they're trying to create the very situation that they say they're trying to defend themselves against. Oh, it's a sick cabal of people in this country, and they really, really need help. I don't know what to do, what to say, except we need to protect our election system much better than what we're doing. And what I'm saying is that there needs to be a means test given to people, okay? And I know what you're going to say about that. But let me tell you something. We have a lot of idiots out there that vote, And a lot of them vote for just one reason. They don't take in consideration the many reasons that are facing this country. They only pick one out of that, and they say they're going to vote on that one issue. Doesn't matter about the rest of the issues that matter to other people, too. They only vote on one selfish reason. Okay, that cannot be allowed to continue. People are going to have to be smarter about who they vote for. And that means a person who's got a plan for a lot of different things that covers a lot of different things. And if, you know, and if only one thing matters to you, okay, then and you're going to make a bad choice every single time on who you pick for a leader. Because you might get your thing, but the rest of the country is going to fall apart around you because they didn't do anything good for the rest of the country. And eventually it does roll back on you. You're going to be put back in the position of having to choose another person to fix this one issue. And then, again, the cycle continues. It never ends. So you have to think broader. When you're talking about the presidency, you've got to be of a broader mind. Local elections are one thing. Okay, you can be single-minded about local elections and stuff like that, and most people are. It doesn't work on the national level because a president has to represent everybody and everything. Okay, they have executive powers to do and take care of a lot of different things. Okay, they got the Senate that has to stand behind them in the Congress in order to enact certain things. That's how big of a reach the presidency has. And the president can't just focus on one thing. And one thing only, like banning abortions, and then that's all he's ever going to do. That's the way Trump was trying to lead. He was just trying to do one thing, give tax breaks to the rich, and then that was it. Didn't do a damn bit of good on anything else, and he failed royally on the COVID matter. So he was a single-minded, selfish thinker, just, you know, like a single-minded, selfish voter would be. And see how either single-mindedness doesn't work in those situations. Okay, these are national issues. You got to weigh them all accordingly. Okay, every issue. So if somebody like me comes up to you and says to you or asks you, why do you vote for this person or why are you supporting this person, and you can only give me one answer, okay, then, you know, that's like, that's not good. Only one reason. There's only one reason why you're voting for this person when there's like 12 issues that they talk about in every rally and every campaign that needs to be addressed in this country, and only one of those issues is of importance to you, and then none of the others matter at all? None of it? Really? No. You're not a very good voter if that's the way you think. I'm sorry. You got to be broader minded than that. You got to be. All right, so that's it for today. Hope everybody has a great rest of the week and upcoming weekend. Tomorrow's Friday. So subscribe, comment, and share. Keep your ears open for any health-related matters. And treat each other kind out there, everybody. That's really important. And I will talk to you later. I'll talk to you, and hopefully it'll be some happier news, right? Take care.